Hi everyone, thanks for joining us this morning. Today we've got Amin Rafi. He first got involved in the space in about 2013 as a journalist working at an online crypto news site. And you switched to chief communications officer at some point. And these days he's traveling around from conference to conference giving talks like this. And today he's going to be giving talk about the brief history of the some of the things we've learned, some issues, pitfalls along the way, in recent history of crypto tools, and possibly where we are. So please join me in welcoming Amin Rafi.
Good morning. Thank you for coming. Really appreciate the opportunity to speak here. Spoke here last year as well. I think this is one of the best conferences just in terms of the diversity of people that attend and the mindset. You don't have to explain the basics as someone said that. Right, I'll get into it. So, as I say, I worked as a journalist for a long time. I've got involved in a lot of different communities, learned a lot along the way, and met some great developers and communities that, you know, really resonated with how I felt the crypto movement should take place. And then from there on, for the past year and probably just a year and a half, I've been working with Nation Sudan, just trying to see how I can contribute to Nation. So we built the website and a lot of other things that I'll go over, and hopefully, you know, share something. Anyways. So to begin with, I want to go over a few things. So the first one is the comparison to previous or historical innovation and how we learned to adapt to it and how it affected us and what kind of a procedure we went through to apply to our daily life. And the other aspect is the adoption rate and what helps adoption in the long term. And this relates back to, I guess, one of my specialties, which was innovation design. So to begin with, I just want to show you a comparison of how mindsets can change very quickly. And if I have time at the end, I'll show you a video as well that was from the crypto commission. But you can see that innovation when it comes out, you know, people are very skeptical about it until they learn and realize themselves with it. You can see the IBM chairman made the same mistake that perhaps Warren Buffett made by saying Bitcoin is a mirage. You know, it's just another thing that's going to pass by. So it's important to understand that even leaders of the industry and people who look to for professional opinion can be wrong, and that was what I've been showing. So the first one I want to go over is the seatbelt. So the seatbelt for me is particularly interesting because it took 9 years from the point that it proved itself to be a very worthy component in a car, probably the most important, saving millions of lives over the time that it hasn't adopted, to the point where it became regulated and became that yes, by law you have to have a seatbelt in the car. And Niels Bohlin was hired by Volvo to design this, and he was an engineer that specialized in the ejection seats in airplanes. And he was asked to build the seatbelt so it can be done for the car. So he came up with a three-point seatbelt, which today, up to today, is still being used. And it was so effective that Volvo actually made the plans for the open source for all other car manufacturers to use because they saw it as a very important thing. And yet, 9 years later, so it was adopted and it became by law that you had to have that seatbelt in the car. So you can see even the progress of something that can save a lot of lives still took 9 years to become by law something that needed to be used. I mean, it would have taken more than a few months to understand the effect that could have on people's lives. Or imagine the lives that were affected by it during those 9 years before it became standardized. So I think this is a really great example of that if there is a technology, you need to learn it for yourself and see how you can benefit you yourself. You know, if you're waiting for, I guess, the big brother or whoever else is in charge to kind of say, yeah, this is good, use it, you know, you can take up to 9 years in such cases, or other cases, probably even longer for it to become standardized. Moving forward, I want to go over, I guess, the printing press as well. The printing press had a huge impact on our lives. I mean, prior to the introduction of the internet, it was probably the most influential thing because it allowed the distribution of knowledge It allowed us to science community to distribute their findings and share with other communities, hence rapidly accelerating the innovation rate of the scientific community's ability to come up with solutions. It also sparked a lot of controversial ideas, resulting in revolution due to the spread of knowledge, books, and a lot of other aspects that were spread around. So it was one of the first attempts at distributing knowledge, and it worked extremely well. And this is again another example of how innovation can disrupt existing ones. And the cause and effect is, it has negative effects, I guess, from the aspect of revolution stuff, but this led to good things that they usually relies on and allow people to learn things that were otherwise suppressed or hidden by the church at that time or whatever it may be. Other innovations that I find truly important, one of the main ones is the telegraph. Telegraph. So it allowed global communication, and probably should we say telegraph. But yeah, it allowed global communication, so people from all around the world could communicate something together instead of writing mail or the traditional sense that would have delayed the communication rate. And the other one is the Industrial Revolution. So Luddite's labor movement was that there was a lot of skilled workers. The weaving machines that came out didn't require such skill because it was automated, it was done much easier. So this actually angered a lot of people and they took to the streets and to the factories and trying to destroy the machines that were, in their eyes, taking their jobs that people had qualified themselves for, that had worked a long path for to kind of get the skills necessary to operate the weaving industry. And then by law became even, I think, punishable by death, that if you destroyed the machine, there were high consequences for it. And this kind of shows another aspect of how technology or something that can come out of benefits, I guess, some aspect of people, and others see it as a risk. So in our case, with Bitcoin, I guess I can relate to it with the banking industry or lawyers, accountants, and other skills may be seen as an obsolete industry when compared to what blockchain and Bitcoin can do. At the same time, I guess we should gracefully accept these and allow it to progress forward. I'm sure other jobs will open up to replace them. So the adoption of new technology. So I wanted to give you an example of how it has worked with some aspects throughout history. So familiarity is very important. So for people to adopt technology, they have to familiarize themselves with it. So an example of this would be, so in an example for this, the benefit should be greater than the cost. So it doesn't mean just in terms of financial application or financial detail, but it's related to if I'm to adopt a new technology. So for example, I have internet banking right now. So a lot of people say, why should I use Bitcoin? And the truth of it is, if you're not really benefiting that much from it, for the average person, there's no real reason for them to shift over. And the average person doesn't have, as most of us may do, concerns about privacy, security, encryption, and all these other things in their mind. They want to simply transfer the money and be able to use it. So this is, a good example for me because it shows that it needs to get to a point where the technology surpasses the cost for them to move over, and the natural people would want to move over. An example of this was the internet banking. You can see throughout a very short period of time, due to the progression of the internet itself, its availability, speed, and people's mobile phone devices and everything else, and the effect it's had on people's need to interact with the banking system. And you can see how this would, resonate further to digital currencies and people's ability to use that on an online source. And obviously this affects the adoption rate because, the easier it becomes to use, the more abundant it is in the technological field, the adoption speed really increases. And another one is the CNC machine. So these were machines that were originally operated by people, skilled workers. And the CNC machine allowed computers to be programmed to operate the machines. And this again had to go through a set of process. So they had to analyze, do we need to retrain the workers so they need to learn new skills? Do we need to change our equipment because of the new CNC machine? So it has a great effect on the industry. So they have to get to a point where they can kind of balance out the parts, find an equilibrium between the other, and we can proceed forward. It won't affect our customers if we go forward with it. And at the same time, you know, this program model doesn't require an operator, so it can reduce costs and it's efficient, it's accurate. And this is another great example, I guess, of something that was man-operated, so such as the, you know, the cash system or something like that, and then moved on to something that can be programmed. So network effect. So there's two types, the direct network effect, which is who uses it and how available it is. So for example, if I want to switch to a new messaging application, I would want to consider, okay, how many people out there use it? If they're not used, if there aren't enough people using it, then why should I use it? The other aspect would be the availability of the hardware, for example. So if you compare it to the telephone sets, how available are telephone sets out there? And these are direct network effects on the adoption system. Indirect would be availability of, I guess, software related to hardware in this example. So DVD players that came out, the hardware came out, and more abundant became people started developing on it. So the software effect affects the hardware, and the hardware affects the software. And this, again, is a good correlation because I can relate it back to blockchain technology, Bitcoin, because you know you have an exceeding amount of work being done in different fields, and then the adoption then becomes dependent on the availability of where you can spend the Bitcoin, hardware that comes out that may increase the adoption rate, and that into itself the security of the software and development process. So those are kind of where historical outlook on how we've done it in the past and how you can relate to what we're doing. And I think it gives us a kind of an insight of what we have coming towards, what we're going towards. So to give you kind of the industrial examples, these are the projects that I've personally looked into and I'm kind of really interested in these. So the first one started with is storage. So storage, in the same manner that you can distribute money on the blockchain, I like to focus the attention, I guess, away from the financial aspect and more into you know, day-to-day impacts of the blockchain technology or any other project. So storage allows you to share your hard drive space and return via water. And you can see, since they went public, which wasn't that long ago actually, it was 3 months ago, they're doing really, really well. So the supply of the farmers is doing really well. You know, the capacity is increasing rapidly over a few months. And it's a very, very beautiful concept because everyone at home has a hard drive. Everyone has access, at least, to some sort of capacity drive that they can use and distribute it to a storage network available for them. At the same time, I don't know about you, but I don't use a lot of my hard drive. You know, I would say probably 50 or 60% of it is just sitting there. So you're taking things that already exist and you apply it to this model of being rewarded for it. So it's the incentive that are introduced by the blockchain and Bitcoin. And you allow people to receive money for things that were otherwise being wasted. So you can also reflect this with Couchsurfing, Airbnb Couchsurfing is free. So Airbnb model is like taking a room that you don't normally use, it's empty. Why don't you hire it out someone and you get money for it? Well, that's a very centralized aspect. So storage, I guess, in that way is decentralized, distributed, and allows you to share something that would otherwise be going to waste. And you can see the difference between decentralized storage and centralized storage. And you can see the effects this had. I mean, you know, we've seen Google Drive, iCloud, Dropbox, all of these being hacked, people's credentials, private data being released freely to the market. And you know, this is a terrible thing, you know, it's millions of people's private information. The fact that it can be accessed on a central server is an issue in itself. The fact that it's not encrypted to the point that even data itself cannot access it is an issue in itself. Relying on a single source and yet cause problems by that because you have a single point of failure. It's always better to distribute the data. And that's what Andreas was saying yesterday. If you take the blockchain and you make it centralized, you take away the very thing that makes it powerful. And you can see, I guess, the difference between what's out there in terms of cloud providers and our computers at home. And you can see the tremendous difference between the two. Another one I want to go over is Gridcoin. I really like this project. I've kind of been following it since 2013 or early 2014. And they've done some remarkable things. You know, we've since seen Folding Coin and Cubic Coin come out as well. But I guess the reason that I like Bitcoin is that, you know, Folding Coin and Cubic Coin takes the computational power that you put towards mining and they apply it to protein folding, this analysis of where you can go wrong with the Stanford University project. But with Bitcoin, you can apply that same power towards all other projects on the mining network, which is Berkeley Institute, Open Institute of, Berkeley Open Infrastructure for Network Computing. And to give you kind of an example of what you can do with it, so you have three different types of projects. So one is volunteer-based and non-profit, and then you've got the commercial for profit, and then the last one, which they're working on, is a decentralized autonomous corporation. And this is a great example because, you know, a lot of arguments that people put towards blockchain and Bitcoin mining is like, isn't that a waste of power? Which, to me, it's not anyways, because even if you compare it to real life, you need to harness, I think, a ton of gold to get 1 gram of gold. A ton of dirt to get 1 gram of gold. So for me, Bitcoin is not an efficient one, a waste of time, a waste of power. But if you were to apply that same computational power to a greater use, you can see the effects that it can have. You know, from a volunteer perspective, you can donate to research projects and help people out. That's a great cause, you know, and be rewarded for it. So, you know, you're rewarded in Bitcoin for it. They've actually applied the system, so you've got a proof of research. So you're rewarded based on the amount of work that you've done for the network. And you can also go and help commercial companies, so video rendering or, you know, any data analysis, so financial applications going through stock analysis. These are very rewarding things. And if you share that back to the community, you suddenly have a self-sustained ecosystem that I think is quite remarkable. So I really applaud them for the amount of work they've put towards this project. I really want to see it keep going forward. And you can see in comparison to all other projects, it's actually number one in terms of recent average credit. So recent average credit is important because, you know, they're competing with people that want to be doing this for far longer. So it has great benefits, and at the same time you can see how much power they actually have when they put to use. I mean, you can see that they're ranked number one in so many other projects. And if you go into the list, they're actually ranked number one in terms of recent average credit. Alright, so Bitnation, it's a bit more comfortable that you can relate to. So with Bitnation, I guess for the past year, we developed a website and we really wanted to kind of put the idea out there and test who's kind of interested in the concept, who can apply for it, how it can work. So the website became a proof of concept. Then we were able to add services to it, test it, and see how people will respond to it. And one of the most important aspects that I find really inspiring is the amount of people that the diversity of the people that have joined the series. And we hope to transform this into the Pangea platform, but just to give you an example, every single continent apart from Antarctica has a member that's registered with Bitnation. And I find this truly inspiring. I mean, you know, in the most random places, we have people. And that's really great. And I wanted to actually test it. So I was going to Montpellier in the south of France just for a few days. I thought, why not contact the network and see who's in that area? What if, you know, we're able to connect or we can do something or perhaps share a conversation or something like that. I ended up being able to meet this really lovely lady and she was more than happy to accommodate me. And I didn't end up going just due to other personal reasons, but she was even happy to go overseas and leave with her kids and for me to meet her other friends and maybe talk about the nation or Bitcoin or things like that. So you can kind of test the community itself and the resilience of it. And I found that really, really nice. But the most important aspect, I guess, for me for Bitnation is helping those that don't have access to normal facilities. So it's not so much for, you know, influencing allies, but it's for people that don't have access to banking facilities, for people that don't have access to proper registration of businesses, land ownership. These are things that cause great disturbances within our world. You know, a lot of terrorist activity is due to their inability to be able to establish businesses, to be able to look after themselves. So if you can provide a way for them to do this in a decentralized manner, in a global manner, that doesn't require them to go through craft organizations in their countries. And you know, most of the adoption we see like throughout the progress, a lot of it came from Brazil, which is having a lot of uprisings, you know, protesting against government and corruption and things like that. And you can see the influences it's had. And Yeah, for me, it's very important to help this world. I mean, 2 billion people, it was 2.5, I recently reduced that to 2 billion people. And imagine the effect it would have if these people started given an opportunity to enter the same economy that we are, to be able to interact, start a business, to be able to participate, to be able to resolve disputes, and, you know, a lot of other things that we take for granted. So that was from the nation aspect. Other things as you using existing technology to provide a new technology, push forward a new technology. So a good example for me is wallet. So prior to this, you know, if I had to exchange Bitcoin, it was really hard for me. I would have to go on local Bitcoins, meet someone. I was a bit always, you know, a bit sketchy. I lost a lot of money through local Bitcoin because of the PayPal things and a lot of other issues that came about. So I really appreciated when Bitcoin debit cards came out. You know, some people see it from privacy aspect and say, oh, we're going back to the banking system. But I think these things are necessary, these tools are necessary. People are familiar with using debit cards. So I use them most when I use the ATM infrastructure is already there. So if we can rely on this, kind of push the idea forward until we're ready to kind of step away from the banking system and create our own networking structure, then I guess that's a good way to go. And you can see the different countries that take interest in it, but for the unbanked countries and customers, the number, you know, it's a very important solution. Because there are no access to bank tools that we do, you know, if you want to purchase things online, you will need like a Visa or MasterCard or PayPal. So this allows you to gain access to such facilities without having a banking, without having to go through your bank and, you know, ask me to provide such services. So you cut the middleman out and then break into there. I think that's really, really important for progression of human beings as a whole. This one I really like because in a lot of cases this resembles how I feel towards decentralization versus centralization. So, you know, if you look at Linux, it's open source completely. So you can go and copy it and change it, do whatever you want to. And you can see how many different places it's being used. And that's quite remarkable compared to something like Windows, which is closed source. And this again shows how innovation can rapidly grow if allowed to be open source. I mean, when the PlayStation 3 first came out, you could install Linux on it, and a lot of people did do that. But then they closed it, and they said, oh, you can't do it, they're going to change the firmware, so you can no longer do that. And I think that killed the innovation. Imagine the amount of development that could have been done on the PlayStation 3. Same thing with Macintosh. I believe they opened the protocol and allowed people to just develop on it and do whatever they want to, they would see remarkable results. But the problem is when you close source it, you are reliable for all progression, all updates, all security patches. So you will have to do a lot more work. The other aspect is a kind of decentralized internet. So a lot of communities are now moving towards mesh networks. So in Greece they did this, in Argentina they're doing this, in Spain there's a huge community, and a lot of other places there's communities of mesh networks coming up. And the important part is this, if you live in a place where you can't really afford the internet, so to say, in some parts of the third world country, what you can do as a community